Good afternoon. I'd just like to start by making a couple of quick comments before any questions that you might have about the release of the alcohol package today. The Prime Minister will also take questions at the post-cabinet press conference at 4 o'clock. It was clear to this government from day one that dealing with the issue of alcohol was going to be a priority, particularly for addressing the drivers of crime. That's why one of my first actions as Minister of Justice was to ask the Law Commission to bring forward their review of alcohol by a full 1 year. The statistics on harm caused by alcohol speak for themselves. It's estimated that upwards of 1,000 people a year die from alcohol-attributable causes. It's estimated that during weekends, up to 70% of injury-based emergency department presentations are alcohol-related. And according to police figures, alcohol is implicated in 30% of all police recorded offences, 34% of all recorded family violence, and half of all recorded homicides between the period of 1999 and 2008. Since 1990, we've seen the number of licensed premises more than double, from 6,295 to 14,424. Of this, on licences more than trebled, from 2,423 to 7,656, while off licences more than doubled, from 1,675 to 4,347. It's clear from these figures that the pendulum has swung too far towards relaxation of alcohol laws. That's what we've been hearing from the public. They want the government to address the imbalance that has crept in, and they want more say about the role that alcohol plays in their communities. Today, the government is moving to meet those calls for action. Our alcohol law reform package zeroes in on where harm is occurring, particularly around young people. The government is targeting young people because, as the Law Commission reported, young people suffer a high and disproportionate level of alcohol-related harm. Between 1995 and 2004, the proportion of young people who reported drinking more than six drinks on a typical occasion increased by 11% among drinkers aged 14 to 17 years, and by 9% among drinkers aged 18 to 19 years. And according to police, the highest proportion of alleged offenders that are affected by alcohol are aged between 17 and 20. Among other factors, these statistics drove the government to make youth drinking one focus of the alcohol reform package. More broadly, the government's reform package aims to achieve less alcohol-related harm, including deaths, family violence, drunken disorder and ACC claims, and a reduction in our binge drinking culture. To achieve these goals, we've put together a large integrated package which we believe strikes an appropriate balance between harm reduction and trusting responsible New Zealanders to make their own decisions about alcohol consumption. The government is adopting in full or in part 126 of the 153 Law Commission recommendations, and we have added other proposals of our own. The government will give parents more tools to help control their children's drinking. Currently, when alcohol is supplied to minors at a private social gathering, there are very limited controls over supply. We will change that by making it an offence for anyone other than a parent or guardian to provide alcohol to an under 18-year-old without a parent or guardian's consent. Where alcohol is provided to an under 18-year-old in those circumstances, the supplier will need to ensure the alcohol is supplied in a responsible manner. If an individual supplies alcohol without consent or does not supply it responsibly with consent, they will be liable for a fine of up to $2,000, and any conviction will be entered on their criminal record. These changes send a strong message to those who supply alcohol to under-18s, including parents and guardians, and we all must be responsible for that supply. The changes, though, more importantly, give parents more tools in discussion with their children about whether and how they should be drinking. To ensure there is a sensible, graduated approach to purchasing alcohol, the bill to be produced will insert initially a split purchase age of 18 for on licences and 20 for off licences. This will be a starting point on which National MPs, as you know, will be able to exercise a conscience vote. The government is also addressing concerns around the special appeal of RTDs to young people. RTDs will be restricted to 5% alcohol content and will be limited to containers holding no more than 1.5 standard drinks. There will also be a provision to ban alcohol products which are particularly dangerous to health or particularly attractive to young people. The government will strengthen the existing offence of promotion of excessive consumption of alcohol by making it apply to any business, including off licences, selling or promoting alcohol, such as giving it away free. We'll also make it an offence to promote alcohol in a way that has special appeal to people under the purchase age. And those changes will apply to any promotion, including TV advertising and billboards. The government will empower local communities by giving them more say on alcohol outlets in their patch. Local alcohol policies will enable councils to restrict or expand the hours, location, and concentration of alcohol outlets to suit local needs. We have tightened the criteria for licence applications. Licence decision makers will now have to take into account things such as the object of the new legislation, whether there is a local alcohol policy, and whether the amenity or good order of the area would be lessened if the licence was to be granted. Existing law will be strengthened to specifically exclude dairies and convenience stores from selling alcohol. Licences will be harder to get and easier to lose. The government has already stated it is not raising excise. However, we are investigating the notion of loss leading and the potential applicability of minimum pricing. We are giving alcohol retailers a year to provide sales and price data. If they're not forthcoming, the government will consider regulatory options for obtaining this data. We are also responding to concerns about addiction and treatment, and a significant amount of work is already underway in that area. This package is the starting point for Parliament's consideration of our alcohol laws. The government does want to build consensus around the finer points of the package during the select committee stage of the bill. We will be listening very carefully to what the public has to say on these issues as we proceed. And finally, just in case you thought I'd missed it, Parliament will lead by example by removing our current licensing exemption. Happy to take any questions, a number of which I hope have been answered with the material that's been provided to you earlier today.
If this is so serious with alcohol, why haven't you therefore gone for a 20 across the board age?
The government was of the view that a good place to start was to acknowledge that on-licensed premises tend to have a more supervisory environment in place. And I think the split, as an initial starting point, Duncan, works well to avoid preloading. That is, people drinking to excess prior to entering on licensed premises. And that was the position the caucus wanted to start from, and I think it's a sensible place to start.
Do you think that the age of 20 could go back on the table?
Well, it's not beyond the pale that a Member of Parliament at the Committee of the Whole stage will table an amendment to lift the purchase age to 20 across both on and off licences. But the trick here is to make sure that the package is designed with sufficient integrity so that if the Parliament votes on the purchase age and it moves from the current setting, that it can slot into the rest of the package without disrupting the integrity of the entire liquor reform bill.
Do you think you get the numbers on that split age?
Oh, look, I haven't done any numbers, Duncan. I'll wait and see what happens once it hits the floor. Bearing in mind, of course, that that issue, as you know, won't be voted on at the first reading before it goes off to a select committee.
Do you think it's a cop-out to have the split age?
No.
Do you think that it's a compromise between the 20 and the 18 and the demands of both?
No, I think it. What it does do is reflect the two different environments and the level of supervision and oversight in those two different environments. And I do think it's a good place to start the discussion. Ultimately, those matters will be left up to individual members, or in the case of our caucus, I should say, I can't speak for other caucuses, but that is the one area where National will be exercising a conscience vote. For the rest of the package, it will be a party vote in totality.
Minister, how will you personally vote on the age if there are amendments?
I've historically voted for the purchase age to be at 18. I'm likely to continue to do that, but I remain open-minded during the next 6 or 8 months.
Do you expect to see then teenagers turning up to parties with a vote from their parents saying, I'm out to direct someone from their parents? And how do you know that's going to be legit? I mean, kids could dock it up in the car on the way to the party.
The trick here is to make sure those that are supplying alcohol in a private setting persuade themselves that the consent is forthcoming from those underage individuals' parents or guardians. The definition of consent in the legislation will be multi-layered. Implied consent, or a consent that has come about because of a history of events. For example, it's not uncommon when that person goes to that place to have a glass of wine with dinner, etc. It would all be taken into account. And we would expect police to balance the usual public interest test when thinking about those consent issues. But the trick here is to provide parents themselves with a tool to discuss with their young people just exactly what they're getting themselves into if they go to these parties, and frankly giving the ability for those people who are hosting the parties, who are under pressure from their own children and friends to supply liquor, to be able to say, I'd like to, but the law doesn't allow me to unless those parents and guardians are happy with it.
So they could be reluctant to. What you're saying is that this would cut down, I mean, you say this would cut down the number of sort of teenage parties as a result of this, parents could be reluctant to become criminals by either or not.
Well, I think it will make everybody think more in a more concentrated way on whether or not holding a party for under 18-year-olds who want to drink can be done sensibly and with the consent or agreement of those people's parents. We've been getting quite a bit of correspondence on this. Parents looking for tools to be able to say to their young people, actually, I'm not going to throw a party unless other parents agree that serving liquor in this environment is appropriate for their particular child.
Just a question, how are you going to enforce that? What happens if the scenario, an underage drinker gets stone motherless drunk, creates problems, police call, where did you get the alcohol? How's this enforced? Who's held responsible and how?
Well, the person who supplied the liquor would be held responsible if the consent was not forthcoming.
What if the people in question don't want to cooperate and don't say who supplied them with the alcohol? I mean, that's common now for police when they pick up drugs.
Well, that's no different to any situation the police deal with every day. What I'm saying is that even if the consent was forthcoming, there would be similarly an obligation on those supplying the liquor to do it in a reasonable way and to supervise it in a reasonable way, similar standard to the type of standard you expect on an on-licensed premises today, Felix.
What do you define Vernon. What consent should cover? I mean, people are joking before about saying, you know, my son can have 6 beers or well, my daughter can have 2 gins but no whiskey. I mean, what is consent? How is it going to happen?
Oh, look, the definitional work which is underway, I've got no doubt it can be layered appropriately. I mean, you can effectively draft these things in a way that works, and I expect the Select Committee, and I'll be saying this during the first reading, Vernon, to spend quite a bit of time working on this issue. But what we've tried to do is put in place a tool for those parents who are concerned about their children attending private functions where alcohol is being supplied and they don't know what's going on at those parties.
What about an after-ball function? How will that operate?
Well, similarly, if it's in a private premises, the consent arrangements that we're discussing today would be put in place. If it was held at a licensed premises, as some may be today now, then parental accompaniment and the like would be required, as it is now.
Is it truly workable? So if you have an after ball thing at home and you might have 45 kids there, are you as a parent expected to sort of check them in at the door and say, yes, your mum said yes, your mum said, I mean, it sounds like, you know, part of your philosophy, I can understand, is you've had this complaint from parents, but are you doing something that's actually going to turn out to be unworkable in practice?
No, I don't believe so. I believe that we can shape the legislation appropriately to be practical. But as I said earlier, this is about sending the signal that actually parents are asking for assistance in this area, and I believe we can draft it accordingly. Now, as we get into the select committee process and submissions are made on the detail of that, government's happy to listen to that process. But at the moment, the current situation where if a function is held in a private premises, there are no laws that are covering the supply of liquor in those circumstances, and that has to change.
But is it possible to make it practical? I mean, picking up on that point, 40 kids come around to your house, 20 of them have got approval to bring in, 20 haven't. You can't keep them apart, you can't police it. How on earth can that be practical for any host?
Well, one would think it would be practical if the parents of both the child hosting the party and those who were attending the party were actually having conversations about it.
The $2,000 fine, would it be for the supplier as well as the host or whoever is supervising it as well?
Yeah, it would be for the supplier in that situation, maximum of $2,000.
But not for the host? If the supply came from somewhere else, is there any host responsibility here as well?
Well, the two are not far apart in my mind.
Why didn't you adopt the Law Commission's regulation around the regulation of liquor advertising? It recommended to move away from self-regulation for the sector, and there's been strong representations on that behalf from some lobby groups as well.
From the Advertising Standards Authority, you mean? I think on the whole, the self-regulation in that area has worked relatively well. What we need to do as a government is send through the legislation a pretty clear signal that there are now some aspects of advertising that we regard as no longer acceptable, and that is product that is specifically designed to be attractive to under 18-year-olds, and particular product which would see will be marketed in a way that, for example, all you can drink, free alcohol if you buy this particular product alongside it, etc. So we think it's time to give that body far more guidance, legislative guidance.
Back to the parental responsibility issue, isn't there a concern that you'll get parents where parties get out of control, maybe a kid's so drunk that a parent would normally call the ambulance or whatever, and they won't do that because they'll be afraid of being prosecuted?
No, I think quite the opposite, actually. If you have in place a standard of responsibility around supervision and good oversight, exactly what you'd do. You would call the ambulance.
You don't think they're going to be afraid of being prosecuted?
Well, I think I actually have a great deal of confidence that most parents out there want to do the right thing when they're either hosting parties or sending their children to parties. And what the government needs to do is to back them in that environment, and that's what we're intending to do.
But you say you have confidence, and then why do you need to penalise them if you think parents generally do the right?
Because we have to give the parents who are sending their children to the function the capacity to have another tool to talk to their children and describe to their children what sort of situation they're getting themselves into. And if you're hosting a party as a parent, being able to say to your child, I'm not going to supply liquor at this party. You're 16 and 17 years old, you crew. I'm not going to do it. And you can complain all you like, but the law says, unless I've got the consent, I'm not going to do it.
Does that not invite kids to then go and have a party in the local park instead? Because, you know, my mum won't do it and my dad won't do it, etc.
No, because under the Summary Offences Act, we're going to extend liquor bans to parks and car parks and hospitals and school grounds. Okay, thanks very much, everybody.